you've been a libertarian for any amount of time, I'm sure you would have heard the missionaries knock on your door, asking if you've heard the good news of Markets Not Capitalism, and was even offered a free copy of the book. I gave it a fair shake a long time ago, and while I disagreed with a lot of it, I did appreciate some of the articles it contained. The parts that I did disagree with, I disagreed with vehemently. In this video, we will go over several of them. Just so we're clear, we're not talking about the sort of left libertarianism that you'd see most often from places like Bleeding Heart Libertarians, with authors like Stephen Horowitz and Matt Zielinski. Though there are some of these left libertarians who are regular contributors there. Nor is this about libertarian socialists like you would see on BreadTube. This is more about the sort of left libertarianism that you would find from places like the Center for a Stateless Society, or from Alliance of the Libertarian Left, known as Left Market Anarchism. They range from people like Roderick Long, who advocates some of the policies we'll discuss, but otherwise is an anarcho-capitalist, to mutualists like Kevin Carson. In this video, we will go over many of the left libertarian positions and my oppositions to them. Just as any group, not all agree with each other, but there is some overwhelming overlap with a lot of them. Left libertarianism and left market anarchism are umbrella terms. So, what are the left libertarian positions that make them stand out? In the current state of affairs, major firms are distorted by the state. Not just by firms who are very close to the state, like Lockheed Martin, Halliburton, ExxonMobil, or Fang, but also with more free market firms like Walmart, Target, Best Buy, Kroger, Home Depot, and Costco. All of these firms are structured similarly because of how the state intervenes in the economy. Things like regulations, the way income taxes are collected, subsidies, the use of eminent domain, and other government dealings in the market and everyday life are reasons why, not just that these firms are huge to begin with, but why they run on hierarchies inside the firm as well. This comes from the history of corporations that are outgrowths of the medieval monarchs. The way firms have bosses like CEOs, managers, supervisors, and the like isn't a natural organizational structure for humans, and would be more likely run horizontally if the state had not existed or no longer exists. This means that you have just as much say on the dealings of the company you work for as anyone else. The process would be democratized, and you wouldn't need or even have a boss breathing down your neck. Left libertarians also point out how the firm suffers from the same problem that states do under the economic calculation problem proposed by Mises. And they believe that it has more to do with the hierarchical nature of the firm than it does the scale. Left libertarians also reject the concept of intellectual property, usury, wage labor, and landlordism in the view that it's creating artificial scarcity in goods to extract rent. They also compare these actions to taxation. Left libertarians reject the use or glorification of the word capitalism, as it is used to describe the status quo, and oppose libertarians defending any aspect of a market system as it exists today because it is tainted by the state's interventions mentioned earlier, and refer to attempts to do this as Volcker libertarianism. Left libertarians are very big on promoting social justice issues like gender equality, trans rights, anti-racism, and anti-fascism. They associate with or defend various organizations that push those agendas, up to and including Antifa. As well as returning the government stolen property, they argue to redistribute private capital goods if they acquired it with help or special privilege from the state. Now, for those of you who have listened to me enough knows that I am not a big fan of a lot of these social justice issues or Antifa, and I don't want to go over that for the millionth time. So, I don't know. Go watch a Shoe on Head video. Go watch some of my older videos if you feel the need to know what that's all about. But let's get into the fun stuff. So, let's start with my smallest gripes first. Now, I have fallen into one of these minor pitfalls before. The use of the term capitalism. When I first started moving away from using the term anarcho-capitalist to describe myself, it was because of a reason similar to this. Capitalism was coined as a pejorative term against market economies, and using a term like capitalism would be seen as defending the status quo. However, my stance on it has evolved into something completely different. I started avoiding it because people assumed that I based my libertarianism on the non-aggression principle, or Austrian economics, which I don't. I mostly abandoned this practice because I now realize that there was problems with my previous position and the position made by left libertarians. I don't object to the term anarcho-capitalism anymore and sometimes use the label, but with caveats. You see, language isn't always objective throughout time. Words change meanings, have different impact, and can even have multiple similar meanings depending on the context. That's not to say that you can't use language to convey objective points or to use it in an objective way. Capitalism is one of those kinds of words. Sure, its origins may have been a pejorative, but it can be used in either way now. The only people who see the term capitalism as pejorative are people who have issues with the market economy and would prefer a more egalitarian economic system. Those who do prefer the term, even by someone like left liberals, would even say they like capitalism, but not the kind of capitalism that follows after a qualifier like crony capitalism or dog-eat-dog capitalism. Sometimes they would like to use a qualifier like fair capitalism or compassionate capitalism, kind of like how anarcho-capitalists like to use the term anarcho-capitalism. Capitalism, as it's used today by most people, is used as an umbrella term to describe a whole host of applied or proposed economic systems that fall under the market side of the capitalist and socialist spectrum. This is used as a way to contrast what they are talking about from a totally or mostly socialist system. Capitalism can mean a very free market with no state and no interventions, to a mixed economy, something like the US. So, when anarcho-capitalists talk about anarcho-capitalism, they're talking using a qualifier. Not these kinds of capitalism, but this kind in particular. Anarcho-capitalists will often defend capitalism without that qualifier, but given the context of who they are and what they're saying, we can easily determine what kind of capitalism they're talking about. But really, did I really need to say this out loud? You already knew this, didn't you? I mean, there's just some things you should just know by now. You already spent this much time speaking English. You should just know this. I mean, even if it's your second language. Come on. This is 101, guys. This idea that we ought to move away from the term capitalism is just label jumping. And the problem with label jumping is any label that you jump to will end up being just as tainted. It will inevitably be tainted by your critics or by terrible people who don said label. If you want to say you support a freed market because you think that people have a tainted view of the word free market, then you should give it time. And shitty people will say that they like the freed market, and your, let's say, duller critics will say that the US is a freed market and will all demand a new word to replace it. But Jim, no terrible person would ever want to use the term freed market or left market speaking of vulgar, vulgar libertarianism is a term that I take exception to. Vulgar libertarianism is the idea that it's not acceptable to defend markets as they exist today because of regulations that act as barriers to entry, subsidies, backroom political favors, taxes, hierarchical employment structures, et al. These firms would not operate as they do today. In doing so, you are defending the status quo and all of the disgusting state violence that comes with it, and it's not a truly free market. Now, the issue that I take with this is on two fronts. One, you're throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Even with a company like Walmart, which works with the state to use eminent domain to seize property, pushes municipalities to build roads for them, advocates for higher minimum wage to hurt competition who can't afford their entry-level employees more money, or whatever charges you want to level at them, they still do good for the communities that they enter. They provide jobs, lower-cost goods, lift communities out of poverty. For me to say that that last part is true in no way endorses, condones, or advocates any of the other things that they do that are unsavory. To assume that this does is extremely disingenuous. We can also talk about degrees. We can say that a firm like Walmart is better than a firm like Lockheed Martin. As a parallel, we can say that we can appreciate an author like Ayn Rand and all of the good that she contributed without also having to sign off on her crazy stances like the state or intellectual property. Or smoking. And secondly, it's selective. On one hand, left libertarians look at the world and find things in various status quos over time that they like and adopt them into the fold. Or they use their understanding on how humans do things in the status quo that resemble how they would want the world to operate and disregard the rest as vulgar libertarianism. Even people who take a strict a priori stance on political or economic theories still look to the real world as it exists today and how people interact in the real world as it exists today to come to conclusions. It's just hand-waving away observable facts that are uncomfortable. One of the good things I will say about left libertarianism is how they point out how mega corporations couldn't exist on a real free market. However, my disagreement is in the scale. It's pretty clear that absent the state, firms would not be as huge as something like Walmart because of the vast amounts of barriers to entry constructed by the state would just disappear. The playing field would be much more open to competition, and the share of the ever-growing pie will be more divided with other businesses. It would be much more gooder. Possibly even the goodest. However, left libertarians take this to an extreme. A lot of left libertarians believe that there will be a huge groundswell of entrepreneurship and self-employed people. However, there is no evidence for this at all. There's no sound reasoning to establish that with any kind of certainty whatsoever. Entrepreneurship is a very tough and very brutal way of living. The skills needed to do it effectively are not something that can be really taught. Qualities that make a good entrepreneur are usually something that are innate to the person's personality or behaviors. Gary Vaynerchuk talks about this regularly in a lot of his content, and he will regularly discourage people from entering entrepreneurship, even though by doing so, he's cutting out a large segment of people who would be his customers. The type of people who would become entrepreneurs are the type of people who are workaholics, who are cutthroat, who show tendencies of entrepreneurship even at a very young age, and have a very clear and innate understanding of trends and how to make good predictions based on those trends. And they have a really great understanding how people operate. They also set aside personal enjoyment to an extreme. They are perfectly willing to eat nothing but beans and rice if they think they can grow their operations even by a very small percentage. The idea that just most people can hop into these and pick up these skills is absolutely ludicrous. It's even more absurd to think these people would want to live that life. But this does get into my other problem with left libertarians: workplace democracy. I have serious reservations about putting important decisions of a firm in the hands of people who specialize in having the firm make things, rather than things that make the firm competitive. Marketing, capital investments, planning, strategy, business ethics, etc. The vast majority of people have a very poor understanding of how successful businesses operate. Their idea of something like marketing is highly superficial. They think that they can just dump a bunch of money into advertising and people will just buy their stuff, when nothing can be further from the truth. Most people don't have long-term investment goals. Most people are unwilling to tighten their belts unless meager days are upon them. They don't know how to strategize, and they certainly have no clue about how trends work, and they think that Facebook overpaid when they bought Instagram initially. And why should they know this? This is not their world. They don't have a knack for this stuff. Think of it this way. The people who exist today elected people like the Bushes, Clinton, Obama, and Trump, and they did so gleefully. They believe things that are obviously and provably wrong, and they are much more likely to respond to emotional appeals instead of pleas of rationality. Sure, you can reason with a lot of them, but most people will not be interested in foregoing a night out for sushi so they can invest in a new machine to sell more widgets. These are the type of people that you want to put in charge of your firm, or do you want someone or a group of people who do understand these things intuitively?
A person is smart. People are dumb, panicky, dangerous animals, and you know it.
Now, while I agree with left libertarians on intellectual property, their comparison of that to rent is just awful. Renting is a service that you pay, and you get more than just access to an area. If you buy a house, you are responsible for everything: maintenance, upkeep, and repair. If you own a home and your air conditioner dies, then you are the one that has to dig in your wallet and pay for a new air conditioner or its repair. If you instead rent, now it's coming out of your landlord's pocket. This is why landlords have so many rules and stipulations that they can put on you, and not so much going the other way. It's their property, and they are the ones responsible financially to make sure that you can live or operate in it. Now, when it comes to living, I prefer to rent over own. I prefer the financial stability, knowing what my living expenses are going to be month to month, and not have to worry about if my roof leaks, plumbing fails, or my air conditioner quits. Rental properties don't create artificial scarcity. Quite the contrary, there's still plenty of properties for sale if you want that option. I don't for now. Now, once I can afford my dream house and have the financial situation where a major catastrophe won't put me in the red, then I'll buy. Speaking of which, I'm back on Patreon now, so disable that pesky ad block, guys. But, speaking of intellectual property, can we please stop pretending that lending money for a profit is wrong? The amount of economic regression society would see if money lending just dries up would be astronomical. How many successful firms just wouldn't get off the ground? Lending money, like any service, comes at a cost. No one should be forced to lend you money for free, and fuck you for telling people that they shouldn't be allowed to. If you can understand the terms of the loan and you agree to it, that's fine. And the side effect is many people start job-creating firms, keep them alive through bad times, and keeps employees from being fired because of a drought in sales. Now, I don't like Chipotle, but you don't see me wanting to eliminate it from Anarcholand. If you want overpriced crap and E. coli served by underage employees, that's on you. Sorry, Shiny. I'm so sorry. The next one I'll cover very briefly, but I feel like I could talk at length about this, so maybe in a future video, who knows. But some left libertarians, like Gary Chartier, say that if a private party owns capital goods, that is, property that is used in the producing of goods for the end consumer, and they acquired this by getting this from the state, if they acquired it with help from the state, or they acquired it with privileges granted by the state, then it is up for the taking by the mob. This means that virtually every bit of property is up for grabs by the mob, since virtually every capital good acquired legally today could be argued legitimately that they fit this criteria. Be it because you have a limited liability incorporation, you used a public service or the post office to transport it or parts for it, you acquired it through a firm who benefited directly, or your industry was regulated that caused barriers to entry, you used intellectual property laws, even defensively, etc. There doesn't seem to be any clear distinctions over what privileges are okay and which ones aren't, leaving it wide open to something like the one drop rule. This is seizing the means of production, but with extra steps. A hard pass. Ronald Coase, F.A. Hayek, and Brian Kaplan have pointed out how firms fall prey to many of the pitfalls states do when it comes to the economic calculation problem, and have used this to point out that socialism isn't as impossible as Mises made it out to be, but still emphasizing it as being a problem. As they pointed out, the problem gets worse as the size of the firm grows. These left libertarians have an alternative explanation. It's not so much the scale, but the hierarchical structure. However, if we look at how well less hierarchical firms operate and co-ops function, you can see that they still suffer from a lot of the same problems hierarchical firms do. If these firms were intrinsically less prone to failures, we would see these firms becoming more stable over the long term. Unfortunately, there's no real evidence to back this claim up. Sure, you could say that the state does intervene in the economy and prevent them from doing better, but if all of these same regulations are still put on other firms of similar size and similar industries. But let's just say for the sake of argument that this is not only true, but it's super true, and that these non-hierarchical firms are light years better than the firms we have today, and it's just the state keeping them down. This leads me to my biggest problem of all, their opposition to hierarchy. There's many reasons why this is a non-starter for me. First, there's risk. When you get a job somewhere, you believe that the boss is paying you a portion of profit, and he makes much more than that, and could pay you more. This is often very false. Sure, there's lots of huge companies that pour in all kinds of cash, but for the vast majority of businesses, there are times when your pay comes from debt. Anyone who runs a business or even ran a business will tell you that there are times where things aren't that good, and there are times where they are starving and running up credit cards or loans just to make sure that you get your paycheck, especially in jobs where things are more seasonal. The reason why your boss gets to take more off the top than you is because it's his ass on the line, not yours. When business is slow, you still get paid. You're paying for that guarantee instead of showing up to work and potentially having to pay your boss because business sucks or the economy is having a little turndown. For a lot of people, this is what they want. They don't want to have to plan for the company's future. They don't want to be the one on the line when things suck. They just want their check, and hierarchical firms fill that demand. Everything in life has trade-offs, and to point these things out in organizational structures to show they're flawed is just ridiculous, because all firms have problems, not just hierarchical ones. Humans are flawed, and those flaws come out when other flawed humans get together. Also, even non-hierarchical organizations like co-ops have a hierarchy. It's just not an explicit one. I've done a video about this, which you can see in the title card here. And the link in the doobly-doo has the entire chapter of this textbook. So, I'll just briefly touch on it here. Hierarchies exist even in the organizations whose explicit goal is to eliminate them. They just come in various other ways, and they still have all of the same problems and trappings that they point to for the reasons to avoid them. Whenever these organizations are investigated, there tend to be very covert hierarchies that exist and function similarly to their explicitly hierarchical counterparts. People tend to look to thought leaders who has charismatic traits who they follow. While they may not have explicit power in the group, they tend to hold sway over most of the voting body of the firm. Time and time again, when these groups announce themselves as horizontal in structure, researchers investigate these groups, and they always find people who are de facto leaders of the group. This can't be avoided because humans, as the social creatures that we are status-driven, and we are not really interested in knowing all of the finer details, and we are willing to submit to someone who seems to know what they are doing. Think about a time where you get confronted with a fact that you're unsure about, and you look to people who you trust to explain it to you. When you form some kind of group and hand over a particular task to someone that you feel is better suited for it, even if that task is more managerial or commands a greater control over the project. These problems just don't go away in a different society as many of these groups studied. They existed under various socio-political systems. Because we can see it happening today, this lays a layer of doubt over any claim that any society was ever truly anarchic in this fashion at any time throughout history, which is why it is safe to say that all of these claims are also ahistorical. There have been societies who have claimed that they have rid themselves of the chains of bosses and leaders, or have never had them to begin with. However, these claims are identical to the modern organizations investigated by these researchers. Now, there are a host of other problems that I have with left libertarianism, which I'm not really going to get into here, like their explicit support of Antifa, their outrage culture, their constant need to demonize and misrepresent those libertarians who they could work with, but because of some differences with their more conservative attitudes, they won't. But those are pretty surface level compared to many of the problems that I've outlined here. I've also done a video about agorism, which you can find in the card here. Now, I'm not trying to say there's nothing good that comes from left libertarians. Quite the contrary. There's a lot of left libertarians that are also really good about a lot of other things, and I do read and listen to a lot of their work, despite these differences. I just don't see this as a viable solution, and this just stirs up more problems than it aims to fix. Anyways, I will talk to you guys later. Worms. Oh yeah, one more thing. Socialism sucks.